The time has come for me to finally do some upgrades to the GTO on this episode of Josh's Car Corner. So it is late February right now. We had a week where it got up into the 60s and almost to 70 degrees, record high temperatures. And then just like that, because it's Wisconsin, it dropped down to the 40s. And then we had a day of freezing rain that just froze everything over. And then a couple inches of snow the next day after that. And now it's winter in Wisconsin again. So I'm out working in a cold, suddenly, garage on the GTO. And there are a lot of upgrades that I wanted to do over the winter, and cost and amount of time to do them forced me to decide on the things that really needed to get done versus all the things that I want to do. So one of the things I really needed to do is upgrade the wheels and tires. These wheels have been on the car for, I think, almost 5 years. I bought these secondhand from a guy who had a GTO, and he had really sticky Falcon Azinas tires on him when I bought them from him, and he used them on his GTO when he did autocross events. And I drove on those tires the first year I went to Road America, and they didn't really grip very well, and I ended up throwing them away. And I ended up keeping these wheels because they were a heck of a lot lighter than the factory wheels, and they had the same profile and width. Now, you might remember when I first bought the car, it had the factory 18-inch wheels on them, and I liked those wheels very much. I really liked how they looked on the car. They looked way better than the factory 17s, and way better than a lot of aftermarket wheels you can buy for this thing. The downside of the factory wheels, especially the 18-inch wheels, is that they are 28 pounds a piece. They're just heavy cast aluminum designed to be thick and really strong and not bend and last the life of the car. They're not really about lightweight and performance. So these wheels are a Vox wheel, ancient design that they don't even make anymore, and you can't even find any information about them on their website. But they are 21 pounds a piece, and they are a 17 by 8 inch wheel. And that was fine when I had them on the car 5 years ago. And back then I even did an efficiency blog where I remarked that I was just gonna stick with these wheels and all season tires in the interest of saving fuel. Well, that was fine when this thing had just a factory engine with bolt-ons around it, and it was only making about 390 horse to the wheels. Now it's got the ported heads and the cam and a couple other tweaks done to it. Now it's probably somewhere in the neighborhood of 440. And 245 millimeter tires do not cut it anymore. So I need to step it up. I bought myself some new wheels and tires, and I have got them assembled, but I have not put them on the car yet to see what they look like. The first time I do it will be with you watching. And I know that they're not going to just bolt straight onto the car. One of the downsides of the GTO is Holden did not leave a heck of a lot of room for bigger wheels to fit in these wheel wells. It's very tight to begin with. As a matter of fact, if you got this car with factory 18-inch wheels, they actually only put a 235 millimeter wide tire on it because of issues with strut rub in the front end with 18s. If you got 17s, then you got 245 millimeter tires. But because they're more interested in getting it out the door and sold to you rather than engineering it right, rather than fix the suspension in the front so you can clear bigger tires and wheels, they just put narrower tires on from the factory, and they rob you of a little bit of performance for the trade-off of looks. So I'm going to be putting these new wheels and tires on, and I know they're not going to just fit straight away. They're probably going to have to be some modifications done to the car to make them clear without rubbing. So that's what we're going to get to work on right now. Okay, old wheel off. Oh, and by the way, something I wanted to share with you. I received this in the mail just the other day. It says on the top, Vehicle Services Department, immediate response required. Our records indicate that you have not contacted us to have your vehicle service contract updated. Please call such and such a number today. You are receiving this notice because your factory warranty may have already expired or is about to expire. And there's a code right here on the top, right here. See that code right there? Starts with SC. Stands for scam. Don't buy it. So anyway, I'm sure at this point you're all dying to know what the new wheels are. Let me introduce you to the new hotness. This is a VMR V810FF wheel. VMR is a company that makes aftermarket wheels, and fortunately, they are one of the few companies that makes aftermarket wheels that have the correct bolt pattern for the GTO. You might have heard on the internet and from other places that this is just the 5x4¾ bolt pattern that the Corvettes and the F-bodies have. That is not true. This is a 5x120mm bolt pattern that, as far as I know, is only shared by this car and BMW. It is remarkably close to the 5x4¾ bolt pattern, but it is off by 0.75mm. So if you put a wheel on there, the lugs are not going to be perfectly centered in the wheels. They're going to be a little to the inside of center, so then you're going to go and put a bolt on there, and you're actually going to side load the lugs slightly, which is going to stress them and kind of pull them outward, which will weaken them. So you want to make sure that when you put wheels on this thing, they have the 5x120 bolt pattern, or get adapters that will adapt it to the wheel that you're putting on the car. So getting back to these wheels are very cool because the FF stands for flow formed technology. Now, this is not a forged wheel, this is a cast wheel, but what is awesome about it is during the manufacturing process, they spin it and they put pressure on the inside barrel, and putting that pressure on the inside barrel compresses the material down and makes it a lot stronger. Results in a lighter and stronger wheel than a cast wheel, but without the price of a forged wheel. So you get some of the advantages of a forged wheel without the cost. Now, I am curious how much these wheels weigh compared to the old Vox wheels that were on the car. So I've got the trusty old bathroom scale set up over there, and we're gonna find out right now. So just because I have a 500 horsepower engine now does not mean I'm not still interested in economy and saving weight. So I've got the two wheels right here. I'm gonna start with the Vox wheel. I'm gonna use my camera so I can take an image of the scale as I step on it. Okay, so let's get on right here. This wheel, we are at 255 pounds. So let's see what the VMR wheel weighs in comparison. We have got 255 pounds. I also have these wheels for the back, which look the same, but check that action out. Staggered. This is 18x9.5. So I'm gonna have an inch more tread out back going forward. So actually, just for fun, let's see what this weighs. So 3.8 more. That is not the end of the world. That 18-inch wheel weighs as much as that 17-inch wheel. We're talking about an inch more in wheel diameter. So we're talking about a lot more of a barrel, and it's a half inch wider. And it weighs exactly the same with a tire on it. The other thing I have to take into consideration is the tires themselves. These are the Michelin Pilot Supersports on the old wheels, and on the new wheels are the Continental Extreme Contacts. The difference I know right now is that these tires are about 24 pounds a piece. These tires are about 22 pounds a piece, and I think the 275s that are on the back wheels are about 24 pounds a piece. So the fact that the net weight's exactly the same and I'm getting a bigger wheel and tire with a much nicer look, and I'm hardly gaining any weight except a couple pounds out back, that's huge. So I'm actually really surprised by that. So let me talk some more about why I chose to go with these wheels. See, VMR wheels are kind of a standard go-to for guys who own GTOs. Lots of guys have the V710 wheels on their cars and have done for years, and they could also get those in a staggered setup too. This V810 style is a brand new style that just came out, and it's in the Flowform series, which the V710s are only in the Flowform series if you go 19-inch or bigger. And 19-inch wheels are just way too big for the GTO because you're only running a 26-inch tire. 18's really as big as you would want to go in terms of ride comfort, because otherwise you get to having way too small a sidewall, and then it's just going to be a bumpy, annoying ride as you drive down the road. The other advantage is the old Vox wheels. The wheels themselves had a 72.6 millimeter hub bore. Now the GTO has a 69.6 millimeter hub bore, so that means there's a 3 millimeter gap, so there's no proper way to center the wheel. So for the last couple years, I've been running these things. These are hub centering rings, and they're plastic. They're designed to fill up the gap between the hub bore and the bore on the wheels. And even with these, I always had problems with steering wheel vibration between 70 and 80 miles an hour, something that would just come and go, and it just made the car horrible and annoying to drive cruising on the freeway. These wheels, the front design, has actually got the 69.6 millimeter hub bore. This is a pattern that was designed for the GTO to fit perfectly without any issue. The back spacing is perfect, the hub bore is perfect. The thing about the wheels I got in the back, the 9.5 inch wheels, that's more of a generic setup. That has a 72.6 millimeter hub bore, just like the Vox wheels. So I might still have to use these, and I'm still not sure what's going to happen out back with spacing and fitment, because like I said before, there's not a whole lot of room in the wheel wells on these things for wider wheels and tires. So now that we've got that done, I want to bolt this wheel on. I'm not going to go with these lug nuts going forward. I've actually got some black chrome ones coming in that I think are going to look a heck of a lot nicer, backed up with this VMR logo. So I'm just going to test fit the wheel on here right now and see how it looks just sitting on the car, and probably start drooling and gawking and whatnot. Oh my God, that's a tight fit. I like that. Oh my God. That looks right. That looks so much better. That's incredible. But now here's the thing. I need to see that when this wheel travels up and down in the wheel well, there's enough room for it to clear this fender and this fender lip. So now I'm going to have to get into some trickery to actually make the suspension travel to make sure I'm going to have clearance for this wheel and tire setup. Okay, so what I've got set up is I've got my old aluminum jack under the lower control arm so I can raise it up. And I've disconnected the sway bar because I don't want the sway bar trying to twist and lifting that side of the car up too. I just want to see what this wheel does. So I'm just going to slowly lift this up and we'll see what we get for clearance with the fender here. So it's going up. Oh, this jack is cold. It's not lifting as well as I'm used to. I'm also not sure how high I'm going to be able to go before the suspension actually starts lifting the car up here. So we're getting pretty close to factory ride height. I imagine before long I'm going to lift the car up. In fact, I think I'm lifting the car up. That's it. I can't do any more. Well, let's see. The problem is I can't see the camber kicking in, so I can't see what's going to happen when the tire tilts in with the suspension. And this is the problem I thought I was going to run into with the front suspension, is because I didn't think I'd be able to get it high enough to actually get the tire up under the fender to see if it would rub. So I'm just going to have to kind of guess that it is going to rub just by looking at it, maybe a little bit. Problem is the fender is already fairly rolled in from the factory. There's not much more you can do with it. You could probably hammer it out a little bit, but it's probably going to rub. Now, because it's already kind of bent over, there are guys that have got these wheels that they buy or they rent or borrow from friends that actually are designed to roll the fenders. And there's only a little section you need to roll. It's right up here, and it's actually already a little bit pre-rolled from the factory. So chances are I'm probably going to have to go call one of them up and see if I can get one of those wheels and slowly roll this in as tight as it can get, just to make sure I'm going to have proper clearance so I don't catch the fender on the tire and chew it up. So take a look at my original rear tire back here. You think I got my use out of this thing? So, the new tire. Fortunately, seeing if it's going to fit, I'm going to have a lot more control back here, because all the rear suspension does is go up and down like this, and there aren't that many points to it. I've actually done this before. All I got to do is disconnect the bolt that holds the shock in place down here, and then I can drop the suspension down just enough to get the spring out, and then I can put the tire on and jack it up, and there'll be nothing to stop it, so I can actually get it up to this point and see if there's any chance it's going to rub on things. The only thing is, make sure when you do this, you don't let this drop too far if you're going to keep your half shaft attached, because you're going to stretch the joint out and stretch the boots out. You don't want anything to come apart or rip your boots. Okay, the wheel's bolted on, so I'm going to start raising up the rear suspension here and see if this tire will actually clear. Long way to go to get back to factory ride height. We're about there. Now we're going to get into the questionable area. It's going up. Oh, wow. Well, that's getting close. Jack is cracking. All right, the tire is in the wheel well. And it is so close. It is so unbelievably close. But I can't tell if that's rubbing or not. It doesn't look like it is, but I can hear it. I can hear it just rubbing on there, just the littlest bit. I mean, it's enough that I can, okay, the higher I go, the more it starts to rub. Okay, now it rubs pretty good right there. If I come down here, so like right here, that's nothing. The tire's pretty much got to get to the lettering before it will rub. So there's the lettering there. It's not rubbing, but once I get into the lettering, now it rubs. So how high is that? The tire's got to get that high before it will rub. And it's barely rubbing. I mean, just. I mean, I can still move the tire really easily, but that is a heck of a lot better than the average GTO owner. The average GTO owner has got to grind this fender lip or roll it or something to get it out of the way. And the reason for that is these VMR wheels, these 810s, they have a plus 58 millimeter offset. So the wheels are moved inboard 58 millimeters of the center line. The VMR 710 wheels are a plus 50 millimeter rear offset. So they stick out an additional 8 millimeters, and that translates to about a third of an inch, which doesn't sound like a lot until you see what I just saw. And somebody with a 50 millimeter offset would have had to definitely grind on this fender. I don't even know if I'll have to, maybe a little bit. Depends on what ride height I choose to go with. I was worried it was gonna be really bad, or something was gonna rub on the inside and it wouldn't fit. The guy at VMR that I bought the wheels from actually said I might need to get spacers to move the wheel outboard. But I've gone around the back and looked at all the places it could possibly contact, on the semi-trailing arm, on the parking brake cable, everything back there. It's got plenty of gap between everything back there, so I don't need to move this wheel out. The only thing I might have to do is just grind this fender just a little bit to get myself the clearance I need. So it's not nearly as bad as I thought. So that's an exciting thing. Okay, so it's a new day and I'm out working in the garage again. And I've got one other project that I'm going to be doing on the back end of the car. I am replacing the factory wheel studs with ARP wheel studs. They're made of a much stronger metal and then just a heck of a lot more durable. And the other thing is they're a heck of a lot longer. In fact, they're a little too long for what I'm trying to do, because when you get them, they're 2.5 inches long. Now, if you run an open wheel nut that's hollow all the way through and you can just have the extra stud exposed, that's fine. I don't want that look with these wheels. I don't think it looks right, because I actually bought these black wheel lugs, which are the same as the old chrome wheel lugs I was using on the car. They're just black. But as you can see, they're capped on the end and they only run out. You can only get about maybe an inch and a quarter worth of bolt inside them before you're going to hit the back end. So what I had to do is I had to cut these wheel studs down the length. I had to take them over and use a chop saw. I had to cut them down. I wanted to give myself a little bit of safety room, so I cut them down to an inch and 7/8. Then I took them over to a grinder and just ground the slag off. And before I did any of this, I put a hardened bolt on the back of each stud before I did it, so that I could back the bolt off and it would fix the threads from where I cut and ground them. So I just got one in. And the other thing that's really good about these studs is they have this knurling on them to hold them in the place of the hub. And it's much deeper knurling on the ARP stud than it is on the factory stud. As you can see right here, you can actually see the knurling on the ARP stud, but the factory stud, you can't even see the knurling in the hole. And it's actually pretty easy to get these things in and out. All you have to do is be willing to sacrifice one of your old lug nuts, thread it all the way on, take your favorite 3-pound mallet and just gently tap. And they pop right out. Back your nut off, and they should come right out. Putting your new ones in is a little more complicated. First thing you have to do is, because they're longer, you have to get the hub in the right position. You've got the parking brake stuff to get around here. So where this hole is right now isn't in the right place. So I actually have to keep putting the car in gear to tighten them up. So I'm just gonna go throw it in neutral quick, rotate it, and then I'll show you how we put them in. Okay, so I got the hub rotated around to where I can get this stud into the hole. So I'm just gonna slide it in the back here and pop it through. Now there's also a knurling pattern in the hub itself, so you just gotta kind of roughly find where that is, and it should find its way into the grooves when it comes time to tighten it. Now what I'm doing is I'm taking the brake rotor and I'm putting it back on, because I want some really strong steel in here, because I want to make sure this thing goes in straight. And having this hardened steel in here is going to be the best thing to make that happen. So we slide that back on, and it's a little tricky because we've got a free-floating stud in there right now. There. So then what I'm doing is taking that same wheel nut that I've been sacrificing, and I don't just drive it straight onto here because I don't want to mar this. So I take a fender washer and then a hardened thinner washer, slide those on, and then put my nut on, and you have to kind of hold it, the stud, in place while you start this, because otherwise it wants to turn. And if it didn't find the knurling, it might want to spin on you while you're trying to thread the bolt on. So you kind of got to pull back while you twist in the effort to stop the stud wanting to turn. And once you get this far back, it should have found a lineup. Just make sure the car's in gear. Take your favorite half-inch wrench, breaker bar, whatever, and just torque it down, and you will feel it pull through. And when it stops turning, back it off, check it. Oh, one more thing that I'm doing before I get started, just to make sure this is absolutely flat and straight, take another wheel nut, thread it on, and just give it a gentle amount of torque, just to make sure that this rotor doesn't move when you're tightening this down. If you're finding the going a little hard, like it doesn't want to go in, you can always take some PB Blaster and cover the new stud with PB Blaster, cover the knurling. That should help it slide in a little bit easier. Okay, so as it turns out, this bolt did fight me going in, so I had to punch it back out and then spray it down with PB Blaster. And the other thing I noticed too is that my sacrificial nut, when I started to back it off, it was coming off here kind of tight. So that tells me that the threads inside it are starting to get kind of gacked up. So before it does any damage to my studs, it's time to throw that one away and start to sacrifice a new one. So that's what I'm going to do going forward. And if this one starts to get a little tight backing off, same thing. Don't risk wrecking your new studs. Just throw them away. Start with a new one. Okay, I've got all my new wheel lugs in. There's one more thing I've got to do in this video. Knowing that when the tire goes way up, it does rub on this fender lip right here, Next thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna clearance these fenders. I've covered the whole thing in tape, and then I have a layer underneath that will show the extremes of where I can go. So I'm not gonna grind all this unless I absolutely have to, but I am gonna grind it back. In some sections, I might go back up to 3/8 of an inch, but I've done some measurements and it just barely rubs. So I think if I can just get 1/4 inch in certain areas, I'll have enough. So the tape will be my outline to show me how far I can go, the green tape. And once I've done that, I've got some fantastic rust prevention compound to put on here. And then I've still got some factory paint, which matches 99% enough that you won't notice. And it's only gonna be on this little section of the metal right here that's not painted. The other thing the paint should do is help protect the paint that's underneath so I don't have to repaint it and you won't notice any change. So here is my grinder. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna grind with the side of the disc that's gonna shoot the sparks up, because that will pull the metal up and that should make it less likely that the paint will chip underneath the tape. Now, I don't really talk about safety a lot on this show, but I am going to be shooting hot metal sparks everywhere with a grinder, and I'm gonna be doing it near a fuel tank. And even though the risk of anything happening is very, very minimal, I am going to have a fire extinguisher nearby, and because I'm gonna be grinding over my head, I will be wearing safety glasses. And I just realized I want the handle on the other side so I can see what I'm doing. Okay, I've now got this fender ground out to the point where the tire is never going to touch it. However, once I started moving it up, I still heard something squeaking and kept thinking it was here, but it wasn't. Found a new problem. It is rubbing right here. Now, this is actually part of the chassis of the car, so I'm not going to be grinding on that, and it's covered in weather-preventing coating, which I'm not exactly going to grind off either to clearance that. So, my choices are, I could either hit it with a mallet and pound it in, or I can just leave it alone and see if it's going to rub. And that's the path I've chosen to go. If it ends up rubbing, what I can do is I've still got these springs with the drag bags in them. So what I could start doing is I could just start leaving a couple of pounds of air in there. Not enough to raise the car up, but enough so that if I hit a bump, they'll help to reinforce the spring and it won't compress as much, and it'll keep the tire from going up so high. So I'm just gonna put it together as it is, and I'm gonna drive it around and see how everything goes. But before I can do any of that, I've gotta take care of all this bare metal that I just created with the grinder. So that's where my new rust prevention compound comes in. Okay, the grinding of the fenders is all done on both sides now. I've got a nice curve going there. You'd really have to get up close to see any delineation in the pattern of metal, see any ripples or anything. So it's pretty good. It took me about a half hour each side, and I'm pretty happy with how it came out. Everything fits really good. No scraping, no rubbing anywhere, so we're gonna be all set. Now it's time to treat the bare metal, and that's where this stuff comes in. It is called POR 15 Rust Preventative. This is serious stuff. This is literally what the pros use. I'm not just making that up, it's not a gimmick. This stuff is super hard compound. What you do is you apply it just like paint, and it makes a rock hard coating that is moisture proof and basically keeps the metal protected from the atmosphere and any outside particles or materials forever. Unless this is exposed to direct sunlight in extreme heat conditions, you might want to apply something over it just to protect it. But otherwise, if it's just in the wheel wells like this, it's fine. It's such serious stuff that the guy at CarQuest that I bought it from said, you need to have protection on your hands or you're gonna be wearing this stuff for weeks. And he even said that if you spill any in the rim here around the top and then you put the top back on, you'll never get it off again. So I'm gonna take some precautions and make sure I don't do that so I can reuse this stuff again someday. I think I've got some plan for the Audi. So I'm gonna pop this off and stir it up, carefully try to get some out of here and start applying it to the bare metal. The guy I bought this from, what he actually said to me was, well, what I tell people to do is, since when you put the top back on, you'll never get it off again, What I do is I take a screw and I poke a hole in the bottom and thread it in, and then I pull the screw out when I need to drain a little bit out, and then I just put the screw right back in. So I'm hoping I don't have to go to that extent with this stuff. I'm hoping if I'm careful, I'll be able to reuse it. It's $35 for a little bottle like this. And the other thing I'll say is you can get it in different colors. I saw white, silver, I think there was a gold, and then this is black. I just got the black because I am going to paint over it. I've still got a little bit of Quicksilver metallic in a can. So I'm just going to cover this up when I'm done. But even if I don't cover it up, you should never be able to see it because all the metal is cut on the inside of the fender lip. So my plan with this, and I'm not sure how brilliant a plan this is I'm going to try to fill the top of this bottle of brake cleaner up with it, and then I've got my paintbrush right here, and then I'll go around. The trick will be getting it dipped in here, filling it up, not getting any in there, and then getting it back on this paper towel so I don't make a mess. And by the way, I should say while I'm doing this, when it comes to making clearance for bigger tires back here, I'm not going to tell you what the right way is to do it. Other people will roll their fenders, and many more people roll their fenders than grind their fenders. The only reason I ground the fenders is, one, it's free, and two, to show you how to do it. I could have paid somebody, and if you want to pay somebody to roll your fenders, there's nothing wrong with that. You will get no objection from me. I just choose to try to do things my own way, learn how to do it, and do it for free so I can show you how to do it. All right, I think that's got it. So now, oh shit, well, take two. Yes, there we go, perfect. Now, one thing I'm a little concerned about here is getting this covered but not dripping on myself, and just making sure I get all the bare metal covered, because there'll be a little ridge on top too. So once I've got the side done, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to lightly get some on there, very lightly, and I'm going to just go over the top and pull back toward me and just go across it, just to make sure I get the top coated too. Good thing about this stuff is it's runny to start, but then once you get it on there, it sticks. It sticks and it's not coming off. Looks good. And that is not going to rust. And that was the thing I was worried about. Perfect. Now I'll do the other side. And I'll tell you what, that's going to wrap this episode up. Now, I'm not done working on the GTO. I've got more things to do. That'll be in the next episode. When I will finish this up, I've got new brakes coming. New brake rotors anyway. And I'm going to take the original calipers off. The front ones have gotten discolored, they turned a really dark red, and these ones are the factory bright red, but I don't really like red anymore, so I'm going to change their color. I'm going to do that, put the new brakes on and a couple of the leather touch-up things before she's ready to get out of the garage and hit the road this spring. So once again, thanks for watching Josh's Car Corner, and we will see you next time.